from a dark, damp, smelly, freezing basement in a haunted dwelling that's old, decrepit, and it's so drafty in here that you have to nail everything down. Somewhere in the black swamp of Northwest Ohio, this is Swamp Gas, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. Well, it's good that everybody is here. If you want on the show, all you need to do is email me at webmaster@unknownspirit.com or go to our Facebook page and like me there, like our Facebook page, and I'll get back to you. If you're not familiar with the site address, it's blackswampradio.net. Alright, now, I just have this to say. Zika virus. The Zika virus. It comes from mosquitoes. It seems to be all over the news. It's plastered all over the place. The one thing you may not know about this, the Zika virus, is that it comes from mosquitoes that were genetically modified and released in South America. And it's already causing havoc within weeks of them releasing it. Now, this is something that we really need to watch out for. And all our, GMO mosquitoes. And all of our warnings about different ways that they could send plagues and kill off people, you know, 70% of the population. What a better way to do it than get mosquitoes that have this weird virus they don't have a cure for yet. You know, I'm going to keep on this story. This story is very interesting to me. And I want everyone out there to keep on to this story, because I think by spring and summer, when skeeters come out, it may just turn into something that really sucks ass. Now, I am going to introduce Rick. Rick Rock is a musician. He's been a musician for 40 years or better. The song you just heard, and all of his music that I have anyway, he has composed it, he has written the lyrics, he has produced it, he recorded it, he did the whole nine yards to that music. And yes, Barrett, it's sexually transmitted to the Zika virus. But let me get back to Rick. All right. Rick has also had experience with near-death experiences. He's had, we've gone ghost hunting together. He's had ghost experiences. He's had UFO experiences, alien experiences. And we're going to talk about all that tonight. And I want to welcome to the show, Rick. Thank you so much for being here, buddy. It seemed like it was so hard to get you here. How are you doing?
I know. Good. I'm doing good. I hope everyone else is doing good tonight.
Yeah.
I'm here in Canada. Not too far away from you, but...
I forgot to tell that to people, that you are in Windsor, Canada.
Another country.
Yeah, Windsor, Canada. So just for that reason tonight, we're being monitored. Who cares, though? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Just across the border from Detroit, actually, Michigan.
All right, the first thing that we're going to talk about here, Rick, I forget Eddie's last name right now.
Eddie Reed.
Eddie Reed wrote the song Born to Be Wild. Rick played on stage with Eddie several times for several years. So I'm going to let Rick go ahead and tell you about Eddie. Go ahead there, Rick. Just... tell us all about it.
Eddie, I'll back up a little bit. Eddie passed away 2 days after Christmas here, just last month. And he was suffering from a lot of different things. He was 75 years old, and he was a musician from this area in Windsor, and then actually worked in Detroit in the early 60s. And he just, you know, the whole thing of wear and tear of your body, you know, he had a brain tumor, he had kidney problems. He had liver. Liver was completely destroyed. Just everything was breaking down on him, and seizures, everything going on with him. And we lost him. You know, we knew it was happening, but it's tough. And I've lost about 5 or 6 people in the last month. Actually, yesterday was the 7th one, I think. We just counted tonight. Musicians I played with, and just people, close people we know, you know, lifelong friends. But Eddie, actually, his real name is, it was Michael Rideout. But back in the early 60s, everyone was changing their name back then. It was like a code thing or so. They, the producers of recording and record companies wanted a lot of people to use different names, you know. And, like David Bowie is actually, his name is really Davy Jones. But because of Davy Jones with the Monkees, he had to change. He didn't want people to, that's documented too. He said that in a lot of interviews. He wanted to change it, so he did. People didn't confuse him with the same Davy Jones with the Monkees. But everyone was changing their name. So Eddie, actually, his middle name is Edward, so he used Eddie Reed as a stage name, and that actually legitimately, legally changed it back then. He was a songwriter from this area, and he played all the clubs and all that stuff, and he was writing songs, and he was married, and he had a child about 10 years old at the time, and he decided to leave this area. He was actually recording stuff at Motown, too. Actually, with the Motown people, a lot of the session people at Motown, and decided to move to California. He was getting an offer to go work in Hawaii doing an Elvis tribute, but not the one Elvis tribute where you dress up like Elvis and that, just a tribute to, dedication to him type of thing, at all the military bases. Yeah. Anyway. So he's driving to L.A. with his wife and his kid in his car, and he comes up with this song, Get Your Motor Running, Headed on the Highway, you know, I'm headed to L.A., you know, type of thing. And it was more like a folky song. That was his style. And he played it to me, how he wrote it, and with those lyrics type thing, you know, and Born to be Wild, you know. And he had most of the lyrics in that. So when he got to L.A., he started taking charge of his life, his music career, and he was working with Voice and Heart, who actually wrote and recorded a lot of the songs for the Monkees, actually, at the time. And so Eddie got to be in the union there in L.A., and he started getting a click there, and he got into a record deal I forget exactly what the company was at the time, but I've got some of his material. Transferred all of his music from his 45s and that, and I'm seeing all these people, famous people's names on them and stuff like that, and his 45s and stuff, and producers. It was pretty impressive. So he was making his name out in L.A., and he got called to not only do the Elvis thing, but he got called while he was recording with Voice and Heart to go up to the Hollywood Hills. There's a band actually from Canada, so we figured, hook you up. You're from Canada originally. Hook you up with these guys from Canada. They were called a different name, and they said they're going to change their name to Steppenwolf, and they're coming out with their first album. They need a couple more songs. Hang out with them. So we hung out with the guys at the time, John Kay and the guys from Steppenwolf, up in the hills, you know, and it was like a drunk fest for 3 days, he told me, you know. It was just like everyone was getting high and all that stuff and that. And he gave them the idea for Born to be Wild, the song that he was coming down to L.A. with his wife and kid. And he worked a little bit with the drummer and the guitar player, the other guitar player. And so they started working on a beat and all the stuff and changing it for him and that, and with him and that. And he gave him another song or something, just ideas. So the record company says, hey, thanks for helping him out. Here's $100. So he goes home and he says to his wife, hey, honey, I just made my first $100, you know, selling a couple of songs and ideas to this young band from Canada, actually, there in L.A. Little did he know that they worked out the song, and they worked on it, and made it a rock anthem, Born to be Wild. And he hears it on the radio in California, and he's like freaking out, I don't believe this. And he was all sad. He wasn't cared about giving away a song and that. And it became a huge hit, one of the biggest all-time hit when Easy Rider movie came out, you know, and with I forget all the actors and all, but Dennis.
Yeah, I don't remember the actors either.
Peter Fonda and all of those guys. There. Anyways, in Easy Rider, and Born to Be Wild was the, you know, the feature song.
Yeah, it was the theme song.
Eddie got to get to go to all these Hollywood parties and all this stuff. He got invited to all this stuff and that, and you know, it was all type of you know, not money involved, but I call it platonic music connections, you know. And anyway, he's in L.A. and doing all kinds of wild things, and while he's there too, he was like the Forrest Gump. Now that he's passed away, I feel like writing a documentary on this man, because he was like the Forrest Gump of music. He was picking up his wife at the time that Robert Kennedy was getting shot. He was across the street with his car, sitting in his car, and he sees all this crazy riot thing going on, and all these people running out of the building and stuff, and then putting, you know, all the tape around, you know, police, there's tape things out there in the streets, and he's going, what the heck? And someone tells him, you know, Robert Kennedy just got shot, and it just happened to be everywhere. So, anyways, I'll make things quick here, but anyways, Eddie later on, you know, got to do some a little bit of acting, because Jack Lord of Hawaii Five-O liked Elvis, because he was doing Elvis tributes and stuff, called him in, and Eddie was on a couple episodes of Hawaii Five-O as playing as just a standby, a simple little part, as a drunk musician in a bar, and they killed him off, I think, the second time.
I never did know what he did in Hawaii Five-O. Every time you guys told me about it, I didn't.
He's in at least two episodes or whatever. They just told him what to do, and he dressed him up, and he just did it. It's favors, and back then, still today, but mainly back then. If you were in the scene and stuff, and people, you know, somebody to come, this guy, hey, here's my buddy, you got in the door. You got in the door. He got in the door to a lot of things. It's unbelievable. His wife has now all these photo albums and all this documentary and, you know, all the albums and stuff he did and stuff in there. He was doing like novelty songs for commercials and stuff. So, he did a song for there's four famous rodeo cowboys that got killed in a plane, and he wrote a song for that. He was doing, all of a sudden he got called to do like a tour of all the rodeo shows and stuff. So anything he was doing is just adding on to his portfolio of things in his life.
Added on to his resume.
Frank Sinatra, he hung around some of the Frank Sinatra girls that they used to hang out with Frank Sinatra and the boys. Frank would call this gal up, and she ended up in a lot of B-movies. I forget her name now. But it's all documentary, and we're watching this documentary about Frank Sinatra, and me and Eddie are watching those. Now, this lady's going to come on this documentary. It was one of her, like, almost, she wasn't really a call girl, but just a really good girlfriend. And Frank could trust her to say, hey, gather around some girls to hang around with our guys when we go up to Vegas. We'll fly you out and take care of you guys and, you know, put you up in that. And so Eddie knew her. Eddie and his wife knew her. And there's pictures of them together. Anyway, just unbelievable things like that. The man really did some unbelievable things. He wrote a couple of other big hits for Nashville too and stuff. And just at the back then, it just, here's $100 here and there. And there's a lot of stories behind a lot of songs in the music industry where people just got paid.
Absolutely nothing for everything that they did.
Pocket money, you know, and thanks a lot. And it was just for the connection. You know, little did they know. And actually, Born to Be Wild, guys in the band never actually got rights for that song, because the other extra guitar player that worked with Eddie, he took the song and reworked it. And very shortly after that, he was actually fired from the band. He didn't cut the band with the producer. What I'm told, a couple of sources that I found out, and But his brother was the drummer. But his code name in the band was that he changed the name was Mars Bonfire. Mars Bonfire. And if you look it up, he is the writer. He is the legitimate writer for Born to Be Wild. And he didn't even make the band, and he didn't tour with the band. And so everyone in the band, Steppenwolf, never made any of the writing of the song. Obviously, they sold the units of the album and tour, so they made money there. But literally, the real writer of the song that started was Eddie, and it went to Mars, and Mars was registered as the writer for Born to Be Wild, and he never actually ended up in the band. Isn't that wild?
That is absolutely wild, Rick. I've already got a question.
The band actually
Rick,
made Rick. He had the, and that guy lived in, I think, Ottawa or so, and his real name, I forgot whether it was real name, David something or whatever, and I connected with his family that, and I was just curious to see, you know, and it's all a true story, and exactly what happened back then. And, you know, this guy's made a fortune on one or two songs that he did with Steppenwolf and never ended up with the band.
Yeah, Rick, I've already got a question for you, buddy. And there's Night Sky, who is, I'm going to be on his show here, what is it, Sunday at 9 on KGRA. But his question is, what are some of the difficulties as an artist today, and how do they differ from issues in the past?
Recording artists or live artists? Recording artists, probably.
Recording artists.
Everybody can record. Everyone can record out of their house now with all the digital age. You can make a pretty good recording now from home recording studios. And what's happened, too, is all the big recording studios are either bankrupt or they're not around anymore, where there used to be 80, 100 people working for the record company. I was close on a couple of occasions with CBS Records and another little record company out here, but the big one was with producer from New York, Stan Vincent, who he wrote a couple of hits himself. Ooh Ooh Child, he wrote for Five Star Steps, which was like a Motown act years ago, and it was in the top 10, I think, hits. He wrote a couple more, but he was working with John Lennon on the Double Fantasy, and Jack Douglas was the producer of, if you look it up too, for Double Fantasy, and I think there was one more album for John Lennon. He also did all the Aerosmith Get Your Wings and a lot of the Aerosmith stuff, Patti Smyth. And I think Cheap Trick they did too, he live at Budokan, that's Jack Douglas. Waterfront Productions was the company. Stan Vincent ended up being the manager of Waterfront Productions. He came to Canada because of a connection that I had, and he recorded twice with me here in Canada. I had an album's worth. It's really, really tough, but that was the late 80s, and it's really, really tough. That was the bridge right there, late 80s. It began to become really tough to make it in the business because you either had to be, you know, in the right zone, L.A., or Detroit's definitely not the spot. Chicago's even tough now, really. It's L.A. or New York, France or Germany. Or England was where you had to go to get noticed to make it. Today, everything's digital. Everything is hip hop. That's on the forefront. But let me tell you, a lot of people are not making money. You think they're making money? Your songs out there or your videos out there, they're not making money. But now you can make more money actually selling your songs, making not 6 cents an album, but you can be making 85 cents on a dollar by selling it on iTunes and that, you get lucky with that.
It's all about being able to advertise and get your stuff out there and who's a fan of you. And if you are a nobody, that is really super hard to get anybody out, unless you meet people like Night Sky and some other people that are in the chat room tonight, and other people I've met, and they play your stuff as bumper music. And Night, by the way, is the person I gave your stuff to, so he can use it for bumper music on KGRA.
Yeah, bumper music is good, you know, stuff like that, you know, You got to build up a portfolio. You can't write five songs and expect for, you know, to make it big. But unless something goes viral, you do something wild on YouTube, and the world is watching. You do something, you either got to come up with something really creative, something new, creative that no one's ever seen before, okay? Or you got to be super talented, like some of these brainchild children now. You're going to see, and you're seeing them, 5-6-year-old kids, 10-year-old kids that are playing out of their heads. I mean, we can never play it because they're rainbow children, they're crystal children. Their DNA is kicked in. I mean, or their walk-ins, where how do they know how to play all this stuff and play circles around everybody? So the viral thing can get you noticed and maybe do some things. The American Idol thing, that's just about done, I think.
They're doing their last.
They've made people. American Idol was only a commercial thing for a radio. Remember, it was only still a reality show.
Yeah, they stopped America. I think this is the last year they're going to do America.
This is the last year. The Voice has taken over everything in that. It's overdrawn. There's at least The Voice has always all good people on there, but it's all commercialized. It's all set up to find and make stars out of nobody, because they can control them. They can control them, and sure, they make them stars. But I've also not just been this. I've been on the other side. And Paul, you've actually helped me here in Canada on a couple of these production shows and stuff.
Yeah,
I've been on the crew on. I set up for just about anyone in
the
world.
Well, you forgot about the Colorado deal that we did.
Oh, that's right. I brought the Blues Fest to Colorado.
Yeah.
You helped me with that.
Yeah.
That was a trip. It rained for 3 days, but pouring
rain.
It was fun.
That was one of the best times. I mean, and that was when I actually met you in person, you and Carol.
Oh, really? Yeah, was it?
Yeah, that was.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
That was the hub.
And then you took me into one of the bars and set up your...
The Gods, the Red Rock, you know, there's something there that brings some people together, yeah.
Yeah, you took
me... That's right, the same time, exactly. And I was doing the Blues, I brought the Blues Fest out there with...
But you also took me into the bar, remember? And we had open mic, something, you had a paying gig in a bar and...
Oh, yeah. The guys got me a gig at a bar a couple of times in that. But yeah. Getting back to that Blues Fest we did there, there was like James Cotton, there was Leon Russell, it was supposed to be Johnny Winter, but he broke his hip or something. He canceled his tour and all stuff.
There was three
days of all kinds of, you know, either local super guys, super musicians from Denver or whatever, or some of these headliners like Leon Russell.
Yeah, I still have the T-shirt that everybody signed.
Paul's helping me working on, and all these people come around Paul and that because... Paul looks like the rock star, you know.
Well, I am a rock star in my own mind.
Hey, what are you playing? What are you getting up there? Because they thought he was one of the acts and all stuff. He goes, "Oh, I'm just helping my friend here with this and that." But it was great. I'd love to do a lot of that, but so I've been on the other side of it too. I've promoted stuff and that, and I've also owned Ticketmaster in this area, the Detroit area, for about six years ago in the 90s and that. Until they went online, and now they're charging everyone like an arm and a leg for service charges and all this stuff, and it's just gotten way out of hand. It is ridiculous. I'm so tired of seeing that. And just
it's just insane.
Getting worse and worse. But when I had it was all cash business, and it was only like $1.50, $2 for service charge, you know, and I made that 20% of that. It wasn't very good. It wasn't, but I did a lot of business with it.
So, yeah,
but, I mean, and I've sold tickets from ACDs, everybody in the world. Yeah. So I also worked at the Caesars here with the Coliseum here, and so I've set up from Ringo Starr to everybody in the world, literally. And honestly, after a while, it gets to, you know, it's great. You can't go Google over all these stars and that, but you really can't get close to them. But I've met just about everybody in the business that was like John Paul Jones and all these guys.
Right,
anyway,
right. Anyhow.
The bottom line, what I'm saying is a lot of it is, you know, I call them a glorified circus. It's like they set up in one town, they tear down. They set up one town, tear down. It's it's that's what it is. It's
yeah.
Just getting bigger and bigger.
You know? I played roadie for a while myself. Yep. And
oh, yeah.
But
you were here. Remember we were I was, up, it was the big festival when all the power went out?
Yeah, all the
remember
power went out.
2000 what?
That was 03, I believe.
2003, remember?
Yeah, I believe.
We're yep. setting up. Hey, people, you got to hear this. This is wild. We're setting up for this show. It was a tomato fest, right?
Yeah.
I was working at that, and I said, I told the crew guy, I said, hey, I got another guy that's visiting here for a few, you know, for a few days or whatever like that. Can he work the show too? And they said, yeah. So Blake and that Blake passed away too of cancer.
Oh, he did. I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, Blake died too. Anyway, he went fast. Anyway, we're setting up, and can you remember it? And we had a break. It was going to be lunchtime, and we're waiting for the rest of the tent.
Oh,
and stuff.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Let me you guys got to hear this.
Dude, we walked into McDonald's. Okay, we walked into McDonald's, and you know how everything is twice as expensive in Windsor, in Canada.
This was Leamington, a suburb of Windsor.
Well, yeah, I was a suburb of Windsor, but I walked into McDonald's, and no sooner I made the comment that I am not paying $10 for a damn Big Mac again, and with that comment, all the lights went out for 3 days.
Else to her too, like, you know, whatever. It wasn't a threat, but you were telling the gal there, and she's like, what do you want me to do? And you said, no, wait, like Paul was using a little bit of his magic. He was pretty powerful with some stuff.
You're not supposed to tell anybody that.
Okay. So it's not voodoo. It's real, real magic, guys. I mean, we can tell some other stories in Colorado where he turned invisible on a police stop that got stopped. We're boring the car from...
You're changing the topic.
Can you remember that?
Yes, I do, but you're changing the topic.
I'm sorry. Okay, so let's go back to Leamington.
Yeah.
When the power went out, I don't know if you guys live in all of Ontario, all went all the way to New York or something for a good day or two.
Oh, yeah. Well, down here where I'm at now in the swamp, it was for like 12 hours or something. They had it on by the next day, but where we were at, where you're at, across the lake, Lake Erie, it was... 3 days that we went without power, and that was
Paul just thought he just blew up the power. Was it in a wall? It was in the Walmart. Remember, it was?
Yeah,
it was,
I thought that I blew. Oh man, you're getting me to tell myself.
You shut it down. I mean,
you're getting me to tell myself. Like, you know, I thought that I blew up a transformer, and
Paul heated up and he shut down the power. And went, oh, that was a good one, Paul. You did really good. So we walk into, which was part of Walmart, and Walmart's down. So we leave the building, and we look there, and we can hear, you know, cars honking and stuff. And I'm going, what the hell's going on here? You know, Dawn of the Dead? What the heck? Everything's shut down. So we're going, oh, it must be just power outage in our area. We start driving out of there and stuff, and we get to the park and all that stuff, and everything's down. Everything's shut down. We're hearing that it is shut down in the whole area. Then we're hearing it's like the whole province is shut down, and states are shut down. It's like, what? Yeah. I'm going, oh, Paul, you really did a good one.
Don't put that off on me. They're not supposed to know that shit.
No. Anyway.
A tree branch did it.
Pretty wild, but that's a whole other story of, I think that was a test, and we both believe that this was a big test of shutting down a grid, huge grid.
Yeah.
Where they were testing something, and something went way wrong. Either on purpose, as a test, to see how people would react, or something went way wrong. It was like billions of dollars lost.
Anyhow,
moving on
to your music here.
It is part of the music.
Yeah, well, we're moving on to that. My question is, my friend, is I would like to know what compelled you to create your own CD. You had one song out that you did with a band way back in the day called The Traveler, which I'm going to play later.
Oh, yeah, The Traveler, yeah.
And then you decided to make your own CD.
You'd probably like to redo that.
Yeah, well,
I've got an acoustic version of it.
Yeah, I have that version. I have both versions.
Okay.
And I play them both on Black Swamp. However, I want to know what compelled you to just, all of out of the blue, create the music CD that you did that is, well, I call it, I compare it to Pink Floyd.
Oh, which one are you talking about? You're talking about the one I did with Carol, just a simple computer.
Yeah.
It was a really rough computer, and I had acoustic guitar and some program stuff I did. I like to redo them, like, with today's quality stuff. It all needs to be bumped up, definitely. But I did a record called Radio City in that.
No, I'm not talking about Radio City.
That's where the first Traveler was from.
Yeah. I'm talking about the one you produced. Well, I think I might have even still... I don't know where I was living, but yeah.
You don't know where we're living. We lived so many different places.
Yeah, that's why I'm called Arizona Tramp, because I wander all over the place.
And you were, Paul would just take off for like hours and go into the woods, and he'd come back with these amazing like tree branches, and then within a day or two, make walking sticks and stuff like that, and shellac them, and make, you know, put all kinds of really... powerful energy on them and crystals and stuff. And we go to the fairs, remember?
Yes.
And people were going, look at this stuff. And they were buying your book of shadows and all kinds of stuff. Remember?
Yeah, I remember.
That was in a small fair, like where nothing sells there. And Paul's selling his stuff just that he made out of his hands. We're pretty wild. We did some wild things together.
Yeah, we did do some wild things, and that since. Why don't we just hop into some wild things? Like, when I moved back from Wisconsin and I moved into Toledo, I ended up with who I'm with now. You know, Rick and Carol. Carol is Rick's wife. We went up to visit Rick and Carol, and they introduced us to ghost hunting. And we went into a graveyard with nothing more than a meter and a digital recorder.
Yep, an EMF meter we have, a recorder, and we started recording stuff in certain places. Remember that other house, remember, which was a club that we were playing? You and me,
but that's later on.
You and I playing.
That's later on. I'll get to that. I'll get to that part of the story.
Sure.
But we were walking around this graveyard. We got an EVP when I was... Well, actually, I was living with you guys before I got here, when we got that EVP, the graveyard here thing, if you remember that. And then we got some EVPs with one, me and Kelly and Rick and Carol got together. And then we went and had ice cream. And after that, we came up another time. Me and Rick were on stage there for a little bit, and then we went through the bar. And we took pictures of, there must have been 500 or 600 orbs.
I don't know if we still have those pictures.
And I've got those pictures on my,
amazing.
I got those pictures on my hard drive somewhere. We had orb. You would not believe the amount of orbs.
Above the house, and we find out later that obviously it's haunted, but not only that, it was part of a funeral home. We didn't know this. You know that other, what was that, Chinese restaurant across, there's that house, which turned into that kind of pub thing we were playing in. And then there's the parking lot.
Yeah.
And right in the back there, that was all part of a funeral home. And I guess a girl was trapped upstairs, and she died upstairs there. That's when we got a lot of the stuff. But not only that, above this house, we've never seen this anomaly. Still somewhere, we've got the picture. I'm sure we do somewhere between you and I.
Yeah.
We've never seen it look like a star-studded, like the night sky with orbs. I mean, serious orbs that were above this house. I mean, like thousands of souls that are just hovered above this house, maybe above the roof, maybe 10, 15 feet above. And it's filled. This is not some type of trick photographer. It wasn't raining. It was nothing like that. It was freaky. And most of the time we took these shots in the dark. Remember all that?
Yeah.
Down the stairs, and it was some serious. And here's folks, if you want to know sometimes about real orbs and that, and energy orbs, and this is where you can truly believe that they're real orbs. It's not something from a flash of a camera or so. When you see an orb, and the orb is like on a shelf and half behind the shelf. Okay, if it was a bubble or a rain thing, you'd see it in front of the picture, not in between a shelf. Remember some of those pictures?
Yeah, I remember like, some of those pictures.
Behind a door, or like that doesn't happen. I mean, where you? Well, I've got chills right now seeing some. Just remember them. A half an orb or so between like a door or in the back of a door. So how is that? You explain that, and no one else can explain that to us. That no. Skeptics are going, I don't know how that happened. And they have no, we know what they are. They're energy orbs, that memory that's stuck there.
It's either, I look at it as either memory images, or I look at it as that is the spirit floating around because it's lost and has nowhere to has no way to get anywhere or something.
And there's material things within it. You can see the not images, but you can see that it has substance within it. It's not just like a round circle or something. You can see actually some type of energy flow within it on a lot of these. When we blew them up, but the ones that are like between a shelf or behind halfway behind a door, you know, or something like that. How do you explain that? No one has been explained, so we just believe that what it is. It's an energy orb.
I can't explain it. What I'm doing, I'm looking
that's
for.
That's how we get. That's how I come up with songs, music. You know, sure, you can write songs all about baby, baby, baby. You know, and make money and make hits and that. But when you write songs with some substance with it, that is from either an event or an experience that you have, or something that touches your soul. That's where it's at.
Yeah.
Money, secondary to all that.
Okay. I can't find the EVP that, I can't find it, but I can find, I'm going to play an EVP for people just because I think it would be cool to play the EVP for people. And so here we go. I'm going to play this and, I don't know. Could you guys hear that? Let me try to turn the volume up on that there. Oh, shit.
There it is.
No, I got to redo that.
That's all right.
Here we go. Yeah. That was, I don't know if people could hear that, but that was, that was in a funeral home here in Toledo on the east side.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, you notice when you hear these, a lot of them, and now there's all these ghost shows that are very popular, and we were doing this, you know, 12, 15 years ago, right?
Right.
And you hear all these, you see all these shows. There's some popular ones out there too. That they go to the most, you know, haunted places and jails and all the stuff and that. And they've really made it Hollywood and all the stuff and that. Some of it's really real, and some of it is just, you know, all we have, right? So they make more than what it is. We don't try to make more than what it is. But if you notice, when you hear this energy or you hear these spirits talk to them in that. It always sounds like it's behind. It's even though it's right in front of you, the sound sounds like it's behind a wall or behind a veil. You know what I'm getting at?
Yeah, it always sounds muffled.
And how can it be muffled when it's like right around you? I wrote that one song, The Hanging Hour, and it's all about someone being caught, you know, in this spirited, haunted area. House, and they can't get out of these rooms, and it's that what hour is like the hanging hour, because it's like, you know, it's like, you know, Groundhog Day. It's just they can't get out of there, and all that, they're around all these spirits. But And why do they always sound? There's never, it's never like, well, maybe there's a few, but most 90% of them is all this sort of muffle, like they're behind a veil. They're behind, even though they're around us. They're, it's got to be the trap between, what would you say, another world or another dimension type thing.
That's,
trying to get through.
That's just what Night Sky was typing in the room, in the chat room.
Really?
Could this be from another dimension or a parallel existence? That's his question.
So it's still behind that veil of that. It's leaking through. It's getting through. But we hear it like it's a, they're talking it through a pillow. Isn't that freaky? Pillow.
Yeah, it is.
Dreamscape, you know?
So, what other... without me around, or as when you were a child, or I seem to remember some things when you were a child. Tell us about your paranormal experiences that you had growing up, if I remember correctly.
I was about 5 years old, I remember, and it was around Christmas time, because my little bedroom, I had a tiny little bedroom, actually, and here's a wild thing I found out later. I ended up going back because I had to, just to clear myself. I went back to that house. You know that? I went back to that house.
I remember you telling me that.
But, yeah. So these people were living there. I says, you know, this might sound weird, but I used to live here, and I didn't want to tell them the whole story. I don't want to scare them, and they had two little kids. But I had to find out, and I'll tell you why, because of that wall. But anyway... I'm in this room, and I find out later that my little bedroom in this house, the house was a duplex, but years ago before I was born, it was one full house. And my little bedroom was the stairway area to go upstairs. So where my bed was actually the stairway going upstairs. And half of my...
It was inside the stairs?
Pardon?
It was inside the stairs? Like underneath the stairs?
No, where my bed was and where in this little bedroom. It was a tiny bedroom, very, very... I can't believe after when I was an older adult to go back to that house and see how small that room was. I'm going... And me and my brother first slept in two little tiny little... They were like special little beds. They were not just single beds. They were even smaller, narrower beds. Just a... fit the both of us in there was pretty wild. And I remember sleeping one time and I woke up out of a dream and the window seal came down. They said there was a storm, but I don't know. In the middle of the night, I was screaming and the whole frame of my window dropped down. It hit my brother in the corner of the corner of the window, hit him in the head. But the whole window pain was in my face. I was suffocating from the window hitting my face. And I'm screaming and they're going, what the heck? And they all woke up. That was pretty wild. That was one freaky thing that happened there. You know,
okay.
How it did break was another amazing thing. But anyway.
Right.
When I was 5 years old, my brother was sleeping in another room at the time. And it was around Christmas time. And middle of the night. And I'm feeling like I'm frozen. Okay? Not freezing. Froze. My body's froze. I could not move. I want my eyes. And from the lighting, they always had a light in the dining room, right from the front of my doorway of my bedroom. And there was no door, by the way, of my bedroom. There was no door, just a door frame. It was always open. There was no door. That little room.
Do you know why? Was there a reason?
Well, now I'm getting chills because you just made me realize. Do you know why? It's because it was a stairway and they never did put a door on it. Isn't that freaky?
Yeah, that's a bit weird.
Yeah, I felt like an orphan most of the time. So anyway, so bottom line is I sort of wake up and I'm like frozen and all I can see. And my vision was like, I could see that they had a little dim light in the dining room, which was right off my bedroom. And it had my mom always had a night light there. Like, not just one of those little plug-in ones. They never had those back then, but that's how old I am. Anyway, so the night light, and everything was like blurred, not just blurry, but everything looked like it was a mile away. My vision was altered, and it was like a mile away. And I'm going, what the heck? Then all of a sudden, everything zoomed in, like elephantitis or something. Everything was gigantic, whatever I was seeing, you know, from what I could see. Everything was like right in front of me, like claustrophobically in my eye, like just huge. And how do you get vision like that? That's pretty wild. It kind of just focused and went away.
Did you notice any time passing by?
I don't know about time. I didn't know. I was 5 years old.
Okay.
So all of a sudden, I see the silhouette and of these two beings at the doorway. And with that little light of the dining room, I could see, you know, a little bit of, you could see whatever, what if they were wearing something. They weren't wearing anything. It was like just at the time, like I might laugh, but like a rubber suit, but it was all rubber, all one. There was no seams or nothing. And, they were tall. They were very thin. They were tall. They were as tall as the top of my doorway, okay? And they were thin and almost like a bluish tint, okay? Like bluish metallic tint. And I tried to scream. I couldn't scream. They froze me. And I had the fear. I was very scared. And I had the fear of that they were in control. Not that they were going to kill me, okay? It wasn't that far, but it was like the control. But they were also felt like I was okay. So it was a neutral feeling, even though you were frozen, okay? And this happened more than once, by the way, but it happened when I was 5. But the first time was the worst because it was like, you know, am I dreaming or what? Bottom line is, which I didn't know, was the next morning, or whenever time passed, because when I did wake up from it, it was nighttime around 5 or 6 o'clock in the day, the next day, and our doctor, is holding me in his arms, in my bedroom, on my bed, with my family around me, and they're saying, you didn't even know who your mama was this whole day. You did not know who she was.
Did they ever talk to you later on about this incident?
Well, this is what happened. They put me in a hospital right away. Okay? Whatever he injected me with, whatever, he put me in a hospital. And I just remember another thing. It just came to me. I never told Carol this either. Before they put me in the hospital, when this happened, I had rashes. I had like these, like almost like a German measles type thing. And they're trying to put that calamine lotion all over me and that. And it was all over me, too. But anyway, I ended up in the hospital, and they were testing me for heart murmur and rheumatic fever. And I was in the hospital for at least 2 to 3 weeks. I don't know exactly. I could probably look at the files. But
wow.
But I was in the hospital, and
2 to 3 weeks?
Was, I was in the ward, the children's ward. And with one other kid in my room. They wouldn't let me out of the bed.
Did your parents ever talk to you later on about this incident, though? I mean,
not really.
It never came back up. Why?
Just to say that I was sick, and they told people I was sick, and that was about it.
You never told them what you experienced?
You know, after when I was like 13, because I had another incident with this, and I told them that I was big. It went farther than this when I was 13 and that. But and everyone just thought I was crazy. So I really didn't bring it up until, honestly, I met Carol. I told my sister. My sister was someone that would listen to me. And she believed in spirits and this and everything else and that. Anyway, I won't make it too long here, but the bottom line is this is real. I mean, it's all real. I was in that hospital, and they were doing tests, and I remember going behind this wall, this radio, this some type of X-ray, and they put some. I had to drink this weird stuff, And to check all, you know, check me behind this wall, I was scared. And they brought me back to the room. But anyway, one of the nights, I'm in the ward, children's ward, and I get a visitor. I wake up in the middle of the night, and there's a visitor at the side of my bed playing acoustic guitar. He almost looked like a country guy or so, whatever. And he was had a vest on, black vest, wearing a lot of black, and he's playing a song. You know, I wish I knew what that song was, but he's playing this song, who's singing to me in the ward at like 3 o'clock in the morning or so, whatever it was. And I'm like, what's going on? I'm like, what's going on? And he picked up his guitar and he just smiled and he just left. The next day, I asked the nurse, and I remember this vividly, and said there was a man here with a guitar, sang a song. She goes, that is impossible. The ward is locked up like from 8 o'clock on. No one can get in this ward. It is impossible. No one came in here with a guitar and all this stuff. Sorry. No. And they wouldn't let me out of bed. They were almost like laughing at me. And I remember the other kid, he was allowed to leave the bed because they thought I was hallucinating or something. I don't know. But they wouldn't let me go play in the children's like playroom and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I was
locked
in bed for like 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah, it was like... Rick, they were treating you like you were quarantined.
Like maybe, but I never knew exactly what it was. They were checking my heart, but I mean, I don't know. They say I had a heart murmur or something. I don't know. Whatever the heck it was, that I was hallucinating all this stuff. Because I guess I told them what's going on, and stuff. And anyway, somehow I got better. They brought me back home, and I just forgot about that whole thing. But I was scared in that room, sleeping in that room, that they came back. And they came back a few times. And I had later, the other visitations was they were feeding me, information, right, telepathically.
Yeah, what kind of information?
Information that there was 6 other people like me. And something about 6, and it was 6 people that I had to meet, but also 6 people that they were working on like me. Something about November 23rd, which I still don't have a clue. But
do you remember the things that they were doing to you?
Basically froze you and feeding things in your head. There was what came to me most out of all the visits, and that was this other planet and this other... this sounds strange, guys, but I'm telling you, this happened to a lot of people. I've been on different shows and radio shows and paranormal shows and stuff, and same people have had the same darn thing as me. So how could that be? Okay, we tell the same story. I tell to a few people. This is after I'm like, 40 years old? I start telling this to people.
So you only remember that they froze you and put information in your head?
They froze me, and there was a planet, and you'll laugh at this, but it sounds like thyroid.
I remember you've told me the planet thyroid.
The planet thyroid, and I used to tell people I went to high school, and I says I'm from the planet thyroid. By the way, and there's 6 people. I'm telling the whole story, and it's just like a joke, and everyone just joked about it, But vividly, this planet is all vegetarian. Vegetation,
right?
And the plants are huge. I mean, the leaves on the plants are gigantic. They're from 6 to like 15 feet. I mean, huge, huge roots, huge. Everything is
wow.
Really green, like green.
Was the gravity any different?
People live in these houses that are actually built on like almost like a pedestal. It almost looks like a mushroom, but it's not a mushroom. It doesn't look like a mushroom, but I'm saying it is the stem like that, okay? A thick stem, and that's
what was the gravity
above that.
What was the gravity like?
Pardon?
The gravity. You know, the gravity is stuff that holds you down.
I would say the gravity is about the same. I would say it's more dense. I would feel it's more dense.
What was the air like? What was it like to breathe there?
Dense, more dense, but you could smell the chloride, or what do you call that from plants? What do they have?
Chlorophyll.
Chlorophyll.
Yeah, yeah, the chlorophyll.
You smell it. I mean, it is that strong. You smell these plants. And if you notice now, but everything's growing and stuff like that. You can grow tomatoes, this and that, and you don't smell them like years ago. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah.
It just doesn't happen. You know, unless you have complete organic stuff.
Right,
you go to
right.
a supermarket, you try smelling. What are you smelling? You're smelling from the motors, and you're not smelling fruit and stuff like you did before. Okay?
Right.
If you're old enough to realize how strong. You go to a market, you can still smell some, but not like it was when we were young. No way. So this planet had, and there's no cement, because I remember the thing about cement is choking the earth. All the cement, imagine.
It's kind of like.
Earth is a living.
All the concrete, all the
blacktop. All the concrete is choking the earth.
It's like putting spray paint all over your body, and you suffocate.
Even more, it's like putting a cast on your body and trying to live through that cast. So this is what we're doing to planet Earth, and that's wrong. This planet, thyroid, or something like
thyroid.
There's just pathways. People just walk, and there's gardens. They live above so they have more room for their gardens and the plantation. And it was just pathways. I didn't see no roads. I didn't see any vehicles, nothing like that. Nothing steel. Okay? Nothing that was metallic that I could see. But clay and grass and everything was vivid colors. And if I was dreaming this, I mean, they say you can't even dream the colors. Well, I sure can dream the colors. But I believe this came to me so vivid, and they put this in me. And I looked around. I mean, I think a couple implants or something. I still got something in my finger here. So does Carol have one too. It's like, I don't know what the heck it is. And I was going to have that. Is it Roger Lear that used to do all the operations on
yeah,
that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, he was. I still had an implant behind my right ear too.
You know, you can't tell me any different. You know, we're here. We're souls in these. You know, that inherit these bodies and live. But this is a contract. But we're interfered with so much. You know, and the whole ghost thing, I believe, is a lot of memory stuff. And a lot of the stuff, if you really dig deep, you can find the answers of things. But we need to be still. We need to realize there's a lot more than what's in front of us. You know, closing your eyes. You know, I literally enjoy sleeping. Okay.
Yeah.
Just
yeah.
To get away from, you know, it's almost like an escape now.
It's a treat to go to sleep and dream.
Yeah,
it is.
And right. Here's another thing. You remember this? I can sense all this stuff. Maybe since I was a kid, I don't know. They did something, but I can control my dreams. I can wake up and I can remember. Because I ask people, hey, what did you dream last night? And I don't know. I can wake up and I tell Carol. She hears it all. Some of the strange stuff. But I can wake up and I can tell you numbers and exactly. The address of where I was, okay? I bring that back with me, okay? Because while I'm in the dream, I say, I have to remember this address and this street, because when I wake up from the lucidness...
Yeah, it's lucid dreaming.
Lucid dreams. I'll remember all this, and I do. So you can literally practice this.
Right, right, right. So we can keep going, or I can play a song, and
a song.
Then we can come back. You know, the one question before I play a song, then next guy wants to know if you still have encounters with aliens or whatever it was.
I don't call it aliens. I don't know. Just it's beings. That alien thing is. Are we aliens? I mean. Aliens is almost like a cartoon thing to me when I hear that, but it's just energy, beings, or whatever you want to call it. Have I had it? Not lately. Not Well, they've left me alone, basically, but the memory is in, and there's certain things there. But when I was 13, I had another visitation. And this happened to me with my vision. This is when I know they're near. They're working me or something. Is when my vision goes to that far, far deep, like everything's like a mile away.
Yeah.
It is a wild thing.
Right.
I tried to conjure this up a couple. Remember, Carol, I think I did it once, try and get this conjure of this happening, where my vision just, everything just pulls away like you wouldn't believe. And then it comes close. It's freaky, man. And I'm not on any drugs or nothing.
Oh, yeah, I know. Rick doesn't even drink, guys. So he's one of those people that just goes through life without needing
anything. You might think I'm boring, but...
No, we don't think you're boring. We don't think you're boring at all. Well, what I can do is I can play a tune. I'll play the Traveler, okay? And that'll give you a few minutes to get a drink of water or whatever you need to do.
I'm drinking water right now.
Yeah. And
Paul Psychic, he figured I'm already drinking.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, get out of my dining room, Paul.
Yeah. Oh, I can't help it. I like being there and bothering you people. So, all right, well, I can play this, and then we can...
What color's my underwear?
I'm not going there. That's beyond a B. Yeah, okay. All right, well, this song, I don't know which version of this song it is. I think it's the acoustic version, but you can't quote me until we hear it.
No, it's not.
No.
Some memories, I leave it all behind. Thoughts are chasing rainbows, always on my mind. Cause I am the traveler, always on the run. Settle down, travel on instead. Cause I am the traveler, always on the run. I am the traveler, following the sun. I go where I wanna go, never gone too far. Seeing many faces as the time goes on. The traveler.
Alrighty, guys. Rick.
Yeah.
Okay. I first met Rick in a program online. Back in 98, 97, 98, something like that. It was called Empire. Empire is now back.
Yeah.
But Empire had this place called On Stage. And I had a room on stage, and Rick would come into my room, and he would play his guitar after he'd get done playing a gig. And that's where we first started becoming friends. And about the time that he started going out with his wife through Empire. And about the time that I went to go meet him, well, I'll backstep, but when I met him in Colorado, what was going on was a few months before that, I had had my first heart attack. The doctor, this was in 2001, and the doctor told me I had maybe a year or so to live.
Yep.
And so I said, fine. And I took off and I started traveling the country. And my first stop was to meet Rick and Carol, and we did that concert deal, and we all became really good friends, and it's become what it is from there. Rick's helped me a lot with my music too. I'm glad I found a way to throw Empire in there, because it's back. You would love Empire. Empire, once it gets going again, it will be great for what we do here at the station. Yeah, and
do you remember we had rooms, I mean your music room and stuff, we had hundreds of people, literally. And we'd all take turns like playing a song or so, and all different musicians would come in. It was almost like a concert thing. And back and forth, we'd all share stuff. And did they have video back then? I think
they,
so.
People
could watch you video. It's almost like on stage, they can watch you playing, and they're all in a room, chat room, watching someone play. Then you take turns. You take turns, and it was way ahead of its time, if you think about it. This was in the late 90s.
They're asking,
way ahead of its time.
They're in the chat
room. Facebook doesn't even have that.
That.
Really. It's a different whole other curve with Facebook. I don't know if Empire will pull off anything like that. I don't know. They scared everyone away by having some type of, you have to pay for it, but they just didn't, they couldn't pull it off. So.
Well, Rick, they're asking for your Facebook page in the chat room. So what is your Facebook page, real quick?
Facebook page.
Yeah, your Facebook page for you.
Just me, Rick Rock.
Rick Rock.
You can find me. Yep, there's many Rick Rocks, but there's.
I can send it to you.
Sure. Sure.
All right.
I've got music pages, and I got my Queen show. I do a live, all complete live Queen tribute, and I'm Freddie Mercury.
Yeah.
Older Freddie Mercury, but.
Yeah, we were going to really talk
good. About I'm playing with some amazing musicians that actually were hired by Brian May to do. They were in the We Will Rock You traveling show.
You see how close me and Rick are? I get ready to talk about the Queen tribute band, and there he goes. He goes right into
I'm sorry. It. Yeah, we just pick
go,
up on yeah.
Go ahead and talk no, about you, it.
Go ahead
and
tell
Rick Backpack. Does this deal, it's called Simply Queen, and the musicians are amazing. He's one of the few bands that can actually pull Queen off, because Queen can be very difficult to play.
Yeah. And we're more of the live Queen, the Wembley Stadium, they're big, when they got big in the 80s, where they were playing all these gigantic, I mean, they go to Rio and they played 150,000 people. We're more the live Queen. I started with a band project trying to do all the perfect Queen, you know, cover all the bass, all the vocals, all the layered music and stuff with another band that I tried first, and it just doesn't, you fall short. But if you try and pull off with the right guys, pull off their live experience, it is phenomenal. And the live versions of some of the songs, like Under Pressure and all the stuff in that, it has more guts, has more everything, you know, and the band just, I can work with the crowd more. I could do that. I just, I'm completely out of my skin with that, because that is the toughest thing doing. I mean, literally after the first or second song in that 90-minute show that we do, I'm exhausted after like the second song, and I've got the rest of the night to go through. And I mean, I can sing all kind. I can sing for 4 or 6 hours, play everyone else's music. But when it comes down to trying to pull off Freddie Mercury at that energy level, it is a challenge. So it takes me. I've got our first gig of the year coming up next week, and then we're going to be traveling certain areas and all stuff with festivals and theater stuff. It's the biggest challenge of my life with that.
Someone's asking, what do you think about Adam Lambert as the new front man for
Queen? Well, they brought him in because, well, it was a big hype because they played on American Idol, and he was one of the finalists there, and they did that, and they were blown away what he did there. And he's very talented. I thought he was just absolutely amazing in American Idol and stuff. Anything he's done solo so far, he has not pulled it off where I'm like, wow, that's a great song, or he's really did great. He hasn't got that hit song himself yet, but they got him in there. I tried out for the Queen Extravaganza. They pulled off some other program. It was so-so. It was a hit or miss thing. What they're looking for with Adam Lambert, they figured because he's younger, they could pull in the younger generation to keep the music of Queen going. That's what, if you ever seen the play, the traveling play or the theater, a thing of We Will Rock You. It's a pretty funny spoof of that, of like a futuristic.
No, I haven't seen that.
Yeah, it's like music's not allowed anymore, and there's like the big machine, the big government won't allow music anymore, and someone finds music again. Anyway, they're trying to bring having Adam Lambert and his powerful voice in that, to have him tie in the younger generation. I don't care for it myself. Guys in my band do like it. A couple of them do like it. The rest of us don't. When they tried Paul Rogers, and that was a different twist. And Paul's saying his style. Paul Rogers is great. One of my favorites. And he sang the songs, didn't try to be like Freddie Mercury, did everything in his own style, more soul and stuff, and with his voice. And it worked for a while, but it wasn't going to be a long, drawn thing. So he did one or two tours with them. But I think they're done. They're doing a little bit more with Adam Lambert, but they haven't been able to even write a great song without Freddie. It's just, even though separately they've written some great stuff. I mean, people don't know some of the songs from Queen. Some of the biggest songs was the bass player, John Deacon. And he retired after Freddie died. He did not, after that, they did their memorial concert, and he never stepped on stage again. But John Deacon wrote Another One Bites the Dust, You're My Best Friend. I Want to Break Free, and a few other songs that he wrote. He's doing quite well, you know, but... anyway, Queen was a unique band, and I followed them when they were like a very mystic, medieval. If you listen to the first couple albums, everything has, even through some of the other stuff, that drone guitars, the lyrics were all medieval. And that's what drew me too, because I believe I've been reincarnated at least, well, I don't know how many times, but vividly, whenever I watch any medieval type of movies or series, or what was the other thing we were watching? We've watched so many things, Merlin and stuff like that. That brings me back to another reincarnation. And Queen is all of that. I believe Brian May and Freddie Mercury are from that era too. They're also from the 30s. They were reincarnated from the 30s because of all the harmonies and all the things that they do, but right. And that's what intrigued me first, Queen Long. And it took me like 20 years. People always say, I wanted to do a Queen tribute, and I used to do a lot of their songs, but I don't know. It's so tough doing it and stuff.
So here's my question for you.
Go.
All right. Are you guys playing anywhere soon? And if so, where?
Yeah. Next Saturday, we're in Kitchener, Ontario, near Toronto. We play Toronto, Montreal. We played in the States, in Ohio, Remember, I passed through. I thought it was last time I saw you.
The last time you saw me.
I drove to your place.
You showed up at my house, and it's like, dude, what the hell are you doing? Oh, well, I got a thing over in Cleveland. And it's like, he tried to drag me to Cleveland, and I didn't.
I know. You should have came with me, man. But, you know, you had life to do so. Anyway, Michigan and Ohio, I've had some offers to play in California and Georgia, a few other things, and I don't know if that's going to happen or not. But I don't know how long I'm going to do it, too, because, you know, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. But I'm a musician. I wrote all these songs. I've written like 100 songs. It's like, why? I want to do my own stuff, but it's so tough to do your own stuff and to make any money. And I gig around here as a solo. I got a couple other bands. I got a new band called the Throwback Kings, and we're doing all the throwback classic rock stuff, just a three-piece straight rock stuff. And but it's tough. What do you make? $100-$200 here and there. But not only do I love the Queen experience and all this stuff, but it's a thrill playing to like 5,000-10,000 people at a festival. It's phenomenal. And that's the only way I get there, not by my original. So a lot of guys that are out there doing tributes and stuff, a lot of us don't really want to do that, but we're doing it because it's a way to get to the crowd, and maybe someday they'll listen to our own stuff, you know. I work with this Elton John guy that's really, really good from the Toronto area, and a few other of the tributes, because I'm in also this Legends Live show, dinner show thing, without the band thing, and it's a thrill. It's a lot of work. Carol works alongside me with all the wardrobe and the makeup and all that stuff. It's make believe. It's like exactly what it is. So you get a taste of people really getting off on whatever they love. And I think the connection of people and Elvis tributes were the first. They're still the biggest thing. It's not because of how good the guy is on stage doing Elvis. It's the fact that people love to be around people with the same energy, with the same thrill of that music and that energy. It's the same with anything else. You go to these car shows, people love the same car show thing. So it's great being around crowds that are like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and it's still one of the
few times.
It's not
just music, it's anything.
Well, music is still one of the few times where you have to put your cell phone down and join everybody and actually participate.
Yep.
And that's
absolutely
one of the things that makes it so great.
And the social thing now online, I mean, people can, like I said before, I was starting before we took the break. If you do something unique or you're amazing, or these young kids that can play circles around adults, there's something to that. So that's another way of getting a viral thing happen, or reproducing a song and making it your own is really big. The voice, you know, people are they don't want them to sound like, they want them to do it their own style,
right,
and blow people away. And well, there's been few that's done it. You can line up, you know, 10,000 singers or 10,000 drummers, and there's only going to be one or two that do something that everyone goes, oh my god, that was amazing.
Well, yeah,
you get that aha thing.
It's got to be that aha thing.
Yep.
So, we can switch gears here, and you have some discussion about near-death experiences.
Yeah, I thought you were going to say something else. You're picking my brain here.
Well, it helps that we talked earlier, too.
Yeah, I know, but we weren't talking about this, about the shadow people, that I had an experience with the shadow people.
Yeah.
They wouldn't let me down the stairway. And they were almost like these gigantic bats. That's how I can put it. Shiny bats, like bat wings. They were literally like bats. And they wouldn't let me down the stairway. Just three or four of them. Pretty wild, pretty profound. And I was not dreaming or sleeping. I wasn't sleepwalking either. Freaked me out, man. Yeah. I've had that, the near-death thing. Well, I think everyone, literally, they don't realize it, but they've had probably 3-4 times in their lifetime a near-death thing. I mean,
right. Well,
what I'm saying is what you bring back, and what is that moment where you come back, or what is that moment that that moment that turns you back? What is it? What sign is that? It's got to be a peg.
Well, with me, I was in a room with this old lady, and she would touch me. She would touch me on the forehead and send me back, and that's how she would send me back.
Yeah.
So, I just had the memories of the last time that we did this on air, that you had something that was what was it?
I'm not sure.
I don't remember. It was somebody in your family that passed. I think it was either your mama, or was it your dad?
Well, both. I witnessed both of them dying their last breath. My mom, I mean, it was an unbelievable thing. She had heart disease and stuff, and they did all kinds of operations, and she was dying. And literally, I went to the washroom. Everyone left. It was like she turned to the worst. They say, you know, turn to the worst. Come on in. We came in, and when I was a kid, I dreamt of my mom, how she would die, and she died exactly how I had basically had this dream. It was pretty wild, and I was a kid. So, you ever get that precognition? You get that? I can. Things happen and you catch. I think it's almost pegs in our life where, you know, this happens too much with me and Carol. We'll be saying something, driving in the car, and we'll say something, and it's not like a common thing like, oh, look over there. It'll be something that is a line or a sentence that is not really said much at all. And all of a sudden, the guy on the radio, seconds later, will say the exact same thing.
Yeah.
That happens way too much. Me and Carol could knock out lights like you wouldn't believe. We knocked out like 8-9 lights, powered in street lights.
No, remember when I was doing that?
Yeah. I remember in that one park, Carol, I was basically talking to this light, and it was like back and forth, off and on, and it wasn't like it was loose, because we could stay in there and not, and wouldn't say anything for like 15 minutes, and it would not move. But the energy, however it was happening, if I said something or like the tone, maybe vibration of my voice or so, it would rattle, it would come off and on. To almost like answering like a dog. It was pretty wild. But we do have energy, and we just don't use it. This is the interesting thing. You know when things are real, or when someone touches you in the forehead, they do it with such ease that it happens. They don't have to try. They're not forced. It's not a forcible thing. They do it with ease. Well, when people... however they want to, you know, spell, cast, whatever they want to do.
What is it, make something
happen. They do it with ease.
It's just like flipping on a light switch, like I used to tell you. You do it just like that. You have that amount of faith in whatever it is that you're doing, and you just make it happen.
Yeah.
You know.
So we're tapping into more. I believe, Paul, like I said years ago, this is your path. You know, that you're going to reach a lot of people with what you know, what you've brought back from wherever you come from and whoever you are. You know, first you're going to be ridiculed. And you went through those years of being ridiculed. Now, you know, you really don't care what people think.
No, I don't.
He's come out of his own skin. Is that what Carol's saying? You're comfortable in your own skin.
I'm comfortable in my own skin, and I do basically what I want, and that's why I have my own radio show and my own station, because then I don't have somebody telling me I can't do something. And then again, it's just like a hobby. I can either do it or I don't have to do it.
But it's more than a hobby.
It's I missed it when I stopped doing it for a couple years. I actually missed doing it. And people like Bear in the chat room and other people like Maureen and so on, they would, you know, try to hint towards me doing it again. Anyhow.
So where were we at? Well, near-death experience. I think people... I witnessed that, and I put my hands underneath her back, holding her hand, and she was hotter than a pistol. I mean, she was burning up. And I said, "Mom, you know, first of all, I just prayed to God. I said, God, you know, take this away. This is just too much. She was suffering for months, and she's in basically a coma." And I went back to that, right back to her bed. No one around. My brother and father was in the hallway, and they just left the room, wherever. I was by her, by myself. I said, "Mom," I whispered, go. "You've done enough for you. This is it. Just go." And I'm holding her back in her arm, in her hand, and she was hotter than a pistol. And within seconds, it just absorbed God. The heat went, and she went cold, like, instantly. It was pretty profound. And I did see that vapor leave her body. It was like a vapor. It's hard to explain. It just lifted. And looking at her within a minute's time, and I called them, everyone back into the room. I called her in the room, and I'm telling you, my mom, she was only 63. And she literally, this sounds strange, but talk about someone who's just the life zapped out of you completely. Her face shrunk, turned like dark.
It shrunk?
Everything just shrunk. Everything just went,
It was like it deflated.
Deflated, yes. Like a football deflating in a darker color. And this may sound funny, but her face almost looked like a turtle's face. It was the weirdest thing. I never told anyone that. I maybe told Carol that once before. Did I? Yeah. It was the wildest thing. It was like she turned into a turtle. It was the weirdest thing in her shell.
Wow. You never told me that part before. You never told me that part before. No. That's freaky.
Yeah, it's freaky. So I've had some wild things happen. I think everyone has. It's. Do you capture this? Do you look for it, or does it just happen? Or you just, you know, coming out of the car the other night, Carol saw a shooting star. I just missed it as I was coming out, but she saw it, you know. And it's just, it's signs. It's. I don't know what you want to call it, but we all have these pegs in our life, and that we got to be more aware of it, you know.
Yeah.
All people are getting sick. We're losing all these people to cancer. It's an epidemic. They're hiding this. It's an epidemic.
Well,
two or three people in America,
Rick, they
are going to die of cancer or have some form of cancer in their lifetime.
Rick, they 100 years ago, Rick, nobody had cancer. They created.
Well, they had
cancer.
Some other things. They had some. This could be a plague too, but I don't think so.
Well, no. They created cancer. They created diabetes. They created polio, and then they fixed polio. They thought they were going to be able to fix cancer, and then they realized how much money they were going to make to keep it going. And so it's been genetically made, and nobody will believe that. They just and nobody will believe. You can give them absolute 100% proof positive that the marijuana oil will cure you of damn near everything. And they will say, "Nope, my doctor says I have to get radiation, and if I take any alternative medicine, then I'm on my own, and I won't have any help." And they
Well, what do you think chemo? The word chemo, CHEM, is chemical. It stands for chemical. Hello, you know. We just had someone in our house. That guy says, "Well, my wife is skeptical about anything natural. She just went through all this chemo. She's going to be gone. It's going to come back with a vengeance." I'm working with some health practitioners now and a homeopathic doctor, and we're starting seminars. We don't care what people say. We're gonna start exposing this, and it's happening more and more. Where, you know, there's alternatives. Not that, you know, no one has the cure, but, you know, the bottom line is if your body is an alkaline, higher alkaline, you it'll kill cancer. Cancer can't live in alkaline. It lives through, you feed it through sugar. And I just found out last night, basically, when you're awake, it really is dormant when you're awake. When you sleep, that's when cancer grows.
That
anywhere from 6 to 9 months it grows.
Yeah, I didn't know that. My daughter is into making people aware of cancer and the good foods to eat and what to stay away from and all that. And you won't believe this one, but my daughter came to me today on Facebook and says, "I want to be a witch." So I don't know how I'm going to handle that quite yet.
But, well, does she want to be a good witch or a bad witch?
If you knew my daughter, there's like in between. It's, you are what you are, man. There's no good or bad about it. And
there's no bad witches. They're just frustrated witches.
Oh,
well, there's the dark side of everything. There's dark side of everything. There's dark side of the medical. You know, there's dark side of the banking system. There's dark side of, you know, the political system. You want to know? There's dark side of every committee. You know, and people, you know, you're never going to get 100% because it's the yin and yang. And like every committee, that even a small little church committee, you know, they're having a committee and they're not going to tell the congregation everything that they want to do or whatever. They have an agenda, and not that they want to harm anybody, but, you know, that's just the way, that's why there's a committee, you know, it's bottom line. So people are starting to wake up, and social media is waking up everybody and exposing everything from food. I mean, there's recalls in food and stuff, and it spreads like wildfire on Facebook.
Yeah, you know, exactly.
I mean, completely. It could be on the other side of the world, you know, where millions of people can spread something. You know, you notice a joke or something new comes up. You know, have you seen this video? Everyone's seen this video. Within 2 days, everybody in the world has seen a certain video or some viral thing, you know. So, yeah. But people need to stand up now, and I think we're going to get more and more of it, standing up and saying, you know what? I'm going to take charge of my life, and I'm going to do what I want to do.
The whole problem with that is that the kids won't do it. The kids that are 25 years old, they don't care. It's a different age. It's an age of entitlement, and they don't care what you say. They don't care who's governor. They don't care. And we have this to look forward to when we're old.
You know, everyone's texting. I mean, they're all going to get text neck. They're all going to have problems with their neck.
Well,
the generation.
I don't know. That's a whole different topic. We could spend 2 hours on people napping.
I know. But anyway, things are changing faster. Just like a woman has labor pains, faster and faster, the world is speeding up. That's why the internet was developed, so that the human experience can experience everything that much faster. A kid that's 3 years old is on the internet. That's mind-boggling.
Yeah. I kind of look at it, though.
And they're asking for, before they're five, they're asking for their own cell phone.
I look at it like this, all right? They want everybody to get so used to being on the internet, and the kids are so, they don't know how to live without it. They've never had to live without it. And when that time comes that they take it away, nobody's going to know what to do with themselves. Nobody's even going to know how to do simple things like add, subtract, go to the bank, go grocery shopping at a store without a computer.
What happens when the power goes out? You think it's not going to happen again?
Well, that's what I was referring to by being taken away.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure what you meant by that.
When they finally decide to kill the power grid for an extended period of time, or do rolling blackouts, or however they're going to try to pull it.
Yep. You're going to see it. And the people that can survive, they know how to survive. And the rest, they're just going to go to the wayside. And look at the movies that are coming out. I was talking about the movies. The newer movies is all about kids surviving. You know, we just saw the fifth wave and the Mockingbird. What was the Mockingbird video? What was the first one? Oh, whatever. Anyway, it's all about children's survival. You know, the signs are there, you know, and only few will be able to survive, you know, be smart enough to survive.
Right.
So either through the water, there's going to be water wars. Are you kidding? This just started. The worst is to come with there's going to be wars over water. Food first, water is going to be, look what happened in Flint. Didn't you live near Flint before?
Well, yeah, Flint is not too far from Detroit. So, that whole Flint issue. You want to hear something? 20 years ago, the only time I've ever talked to my half-sister from when my father was previously married, the only time she contacted me through Social Security number or something, and the only time I ever talked to her about at all, I was living in Cincinnati. I told her that there was going to be an issue with Flint's water. She told me I was full of it, and she got upset with me for a few different reasons, and we've never talked again. And it's like, I don't know, it's like a great big fat told you so, and as far as I'm concerned.
I know. Like you said, you can see things, you might see things 15, 20 years, just something comes to you, and you just have that gut feeling, you know, and it's happened. It's definitely happening. I mean, this is not going to be a quick fix. Just giving people bottles of water, that, you know what I mean? That's great. They're helping them out for the forefront of it.
But the
bottom line is all the piping, all the system, all everything, it's suicidal. I mean,
the whole Flint issue, I feel like what they're trying to do is just kill the town so the whole population has to move, because there's something else.
Someone tried to kill anybody. I think they just wouldn't. It was neglect. And they just let it slide. And it was like, oh, well, we'll just deal with it, or we don't have the money or whatever. But they knew. They knew. And the governor actually knew. And he's so busy, he had the state of the state here.
I'm thinking it was a distraction for something else greater that's going on.
I don't think so. I just think they just neglected it.
Well, the whole algae...
Like, blame someone else.
The whole algae bloom issue that's going on here where I'm at, where we had to go 3 days with no water because the algae bloom in Lake Erie contaminated the water to the point where it wasn't drinkable, because Toledo was stupid and didn't put their the water intake low enough in the lake, and it sucked up the surface water and contaminated everything. And they want to blame that on every single issue but the issue at hand. And the whole issue is that Monsanto is behind it. 30 years ago, there was no algae bloom in Lake Erie. Monsanto's fertilizers get washed into the lake, and algae blooms grow that are poisonous, but they don't want to deal with Monsanto. No, they want to try to put it off on the farmers and tell the farmers they have to do this, that, and the other thing. But it's Monsanto that did it, you know, but they don't want to go after Monsanto. And it's just the way they do the whole thing. They distract you from the truth. They won't go after Monsanto.
Right. So how do you fix it? You're not going to fix it. People just, it's going to be destruction. You know, I'm not saying, you know, thinking too dark where we're on the eve of the destruction, but it's all happening around us with the food, the water. It's not getting better. It's not getting better. Not at all. But so you have to be able to work around it. And, okay, you know, after all these years, we're finding out that this type of food, or this, how you cook this, or you did this, or these pans are toxic, or, you know, you know what I mean? After millions and millions of these things were sold, you know, it's like, what? Really? You know, even I've heard some crazy stuff about the dashboards in some cars are so toxic, it's unbelievable. And when the sun hits it in the summertime, there's so much toxic coming from. And so you should always have your windows down or cracked, you know, in the summertime, because the toxins within your, and You know, no one put any restrictions on what went inside the car, you know, like dashboards and stuff. Isn't that profound? So what's killing us all? Everything that's, you know, the last 100 years, 116 years or so, we were in the industrial age and everything boomed, right? Well, now we're in the technology age and we're in the social age now, realizing that in the last 100 years, we've really went backwards and messed up on a lot of things. So,
yeah, and
you know, you can complain about it, you can whine about it, you can, you know, it's hard to do something yourself about it, but the bottom line is it's good to have the information, okay, and not flip out about it, take drugs on, you know, it's like, oh, I'm so depressed about everything, I'm just fed up, I want to escape. No, it's good to know about the information, wake up,
well,
okay,
they've
but
created
not, not
that
be
society.
Bummed out about it.
They have created the society where people, you know, it, you know, they take a pill. And we knew when we were kids, Rick, that it would become like this. Our parents, my dad used to tell me about, there's going to be a pill for everything. My dad read 1984 before it was cool, you know, when it first came out or something. And he always talked about that movie. He was into Jonathan Livingston Seagull. He liked the time travel thing. And that's a whole nother area. But oh, I just had a brain fart, but something will come back.
Right.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Well? Well. Anyway, thank you. Where was I going to go? I don't remember.
Just the way everything's happening.
Yeah,
everything's happening at the speed that things are happening, and there's some good things happening in the world. But there's, I think we're at a stage where we have to pull up our socks ourselves, and not flip out about things, but be aware of it. We're all waking up to things, waking up to, you know, the.
Yeah. I remember where I was going. It's like they.
Big Brother.
They developed it so that everybody, you know, the fix for the pills and the fix for, it's not your fault, it's somebody else's fault.
Yeah.
And nobody has to take responsibility for anything.
No.
And nobody has to deal with any issues because, okay, well, we're going to throw you on this antidepressive stuff instead of you realizing that you really can't stand your job to the point you want to kill yourself or somebody else. You know, so...
It's something like 40% of women at the age of 40 are on some type of antidepressant right now.
Something like that.
Is that insane?
That's absolutely nuts.
Yeah. And who knows what the men are on, you know? You know, they just drink themselves out of, you know.
Well, you know.
Let's keep everyone busy with so many different events during the year. Let's celebrate, you know, St. Patty's Day. And this month, we've got two celebrations here now. So everyone can get stupid, silly, and forget about all the troubles every other two or three weeks.
Well, it's either
I know,
that,
I play for all the events. I see it. It's sometimes I believe... You know, we have legions here. I play at a lot of the legions. And that's the most active places. The bar scene is dead. I mean, dead. The legions are filling up because of, you know, no one's got nowhere else to go. It's cheaper to drink. But they have events. The baby boomers, you know.
Well, it's either or it's...
Now they're into rock and roll. You don't have to go there and play all, you know, all that old...
country.
You know,
country music,
the old stuff.
Folk
you can
music.
Go there and play what
bluegrass.
You want, and because that's where it's hip. It's over here. It is anyway. But they have an event for everything.
Well,
they
it's
make
either
up these events.
It's either go
it's,
someplace.
It's just the drink, and everyone just, you know, forget about their troubles.
It's either go someplace or stay at home and bury yourself in the television 24/7.
Right, right. And everything on the television's been done before. I mean, come on, you know. I can't sit through any sitcom or anything. It's been over. It's been done.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm going to end the show by playing a song, another song by Rick. And I want to thank Rick so much for being here tonight.
Well, thank you. Thank you, everybody else. Let's make things happen, man. Let's get behind Paul here. You get behind this vehicle he's putting together here, and to connect with some people. It's going to be very, very interesting topics and people, because believe it or not, you've got a lot of resources that you've worked around in your life with that, and you put them all together, and it's phenomenal. So, you know, that's right. It. That's the glue that we need.
Okay, guys.
You got it.
So, thank you for taking the time. I know you had other issues going on at your house, but you took the time anyway to be on the radio show, and I deeply appreciate it.
Just happened all at once, you know. Sad news and some other things going on.
I very, very deeply appreciate it, because otherwise it would have been a rerun, because there would have been nothing, you know. So
we're good.
You take care.
We're blood, man. It's all good.
I give hugs to Sis.
Your stuff is still in our house here, man. Stuff you made is still around.
Well, that flatters me. Cool. That's very cool.
The wizard's still here. We still have the wizard somewhere.
Cool, cool. All
Does
right.
that blow your mind or what?
Yeah.
Your wood carvings are still here.
Cool. All right. Well, I will talk to you later then, Rick, and you have a good night. And I will talk to you again tomorrow.
Hey, everybody.
All right. I'll see you,
Take
Rick.
Care.
All right, guys. Thanks for being here tonight. Rick is awesome. And it was a good show. And I know a lot of you people enjoyed it. And this song, I don't remember the name of it right off the top of my head. Let me start it here.
Oh, won't you buy me a drink?
There you go.
Another round.
Good night, everybody.
Leave the waitress a buckle to wear. Buy me a drink. Give the bartender a tip. He's working hard every shift. Slip the waitress a buckle to wear. Buy me a drink. Saturday night at the local well, buying drinks, everyone's your pal. Slamming shooters and chasers, calling this pretty waitress. Don't try to hustle your chamba, you know she don't give a damn. What the heck, let's just party. Raise your glass and sing again. Oh, won't you buy me a drink? Another round, don't you think? Leave the waitress a buckle or two and buy me a drink. Give the bartender a tip. He's working hard every shift. Slip the waitress a buckle or two and buy me a drink. Don't ask for a number, she'll just come back with your check. Hey, don't slam your glass in anger, she's moving as fast as she can. Yeah, sure, changing her is trouble, she'll leave you dry in the mouth. If you want better service, you better smile and treat her well. Oh, won't you buy me a drink? Another round, don't you think? Leave the waitress a buck or two and buy me a drink. Give the bartender a tip. She's working hard every shift. Slip the waitress a buck or two and buy me a drink. Looking like a fool with my hat on, on a stool out of stander. Look at the crowd on the dance floor, going crazy, getting ready. buy me a drink. Just one more round, don't you think? Leave the waitress a buckle or two and buy me a drink. Throw the barmaid a kiss. She's working hard every shift. Slip the waitress a buckle or two and buy me a drink.
And this is Black Swamp Radio, and I hope you all enjoyed having Rick Rock on. And we switch back to our local programming.
I know it was just a dream. I know I didn't have an anal probe. And I know that I am not under alien control.
I love to sing about the moon and the June and the springer. I love to sing about a sky of blue or a keyboard two.
What the hell was that?
He is under alien control.
Stop singing. His butt is linked up to the visitor.
Son of a bitch.